load versus displacement curve for the column. Next. So see here, this is load pattern or loading protocol in terms of displacement control. Okay, next. So this is one specimen at the end of the test. You can see here on the display, on the laptop, you can see the load versus displacement curve, but it's not quite clear here. You can maybe see it later. Next. So this is video shows the load versus displacement curve cyclic loading. You just see. So this is captured from the computer itself. I make a snapshot for the screen, snapshot video. Okay? Next. So some test observation, it's going to classify to the joining cracks, plastic hinge development, and stub crack patterns. So we see here also we observe diagonal cracks at the mid-column connections, and also there's two LVDTs to measure these shear deformations. So we got plastic hinge developed at the beam column interface. As we see here, the concrete is spoiled and the bars are gilded and buckled. Here the close view for the cracks inside the slabs. So load deformation curve, this is the formula which is used to measure the load deformation curve. This is all already you have seen it after exporting it from the software. So this is load column shear versus drift ratio for the sub-assemblies. And this is all the result of the all four specimens and the cyclic loading. If you see this one, you are going to see the first specimen without slab, the blue line. But there's all the second, third, and fourth one with slab. Just look to this one in the tension. What will happen? Here, you see, here approximately is less than 60, but due to the presence of a slab, it goes more than 90. Why? Because this tension slab is coming and interacts structurally, and we are not considering this during the design phase. This is close if you can see from the envelope curve. You can see that the blue line is the for the subassembly without slab, others the others is with slab. We just see here, slab is contribute where? In compression or tension? In tension form, look at the bottom. But in compression, it has small contribution. So this is also beam elongation. We found that the specimen without slab has more elongation or more capability to increase in strength. So as we said also, we have some strain gauge. This strain gauge will be located on the slab bars. So this is the pattern of the strain in all these slab bars. So I'm just going to skip this one and go fast. So based upon the value of the strain in these bars, we start to calculate the effective depth, the effective of the flange under tension. So then we compare it with the American and New Zealand and experimental measurement, and we found that whatever provision is given by American and New Zealand standard is not satisfied. It's need more. We need to consider more thick slab with beam. So the shear deformation, which is located at the center of the or the intersection zone between the beam and column. So we use this formula to calculate the shear deformation, and also to find the shear at the joint. We use this formula. So this diagram shows the shear deformations with the code limitations. You see for beam column connection without slab is okay, but if there's a slab, you see that there is very close to the failure. So for that reason, we should take care for the joining itself. It can be premature failure can occur at any time if there's a slab, and this slab we didn't consider it properly during the design phase. So this shows that the amount of increase in the joint shear stress due to the tension slab is increased between 32% to 42% normally, if you are not going to consider the slab properly. So at the kind of investigation, we use Rumaco software. So we use simple element, spring element, multi-spring element. So multi-spring element is going to simulate the concrete under compression. It has strength in the compression, but has tension zeros, the tension for, action. So this joint, we add only one, the stab element. The stab element is chosen in such a way that to take only effective segment. So based upon the experimental measurements, we found that the part which is close to the joint has more contribution. You see that the spring which is located in the slab, which is very close to the connection, is big spring. So once it goes far from the joint, it starts to reduce by its size. So for that reason, we selected step by step, gradually, thick spring, then a small spring, up to the end of the effective segment. So to validate this model, we use three sub-assembly, because there is three cases. Either the joint could be in the center, as we tested, either it could be on the external, or either it could be at the edge. It's called edge connections. So it is A, B, and C type. So we use these literatures, measurements, to validate our model. And we found good comparison for the interior, for the edge beam connection, for the exterior beam connection with the previous experimental measurements. And also, we got very close values, results, with the, our experimental measurements for the beam rotation, beam moment versus rotation, and beam versus drift ratio. This is also captured by the beam growth and the energy dissipation capacity also. So another thing, so we didn't stop at this point. We thought that this joint is a part of the structure. We have to think about whatever we did for that particular joint. We have to do it for what? For the entire frame, which is my prototype frame. Then after that, to see what's the seismic behavior of that frame. So this I use this dynamic analysis parameters and use three earthquake motions. In the central, northage, and Cuba earthquake, and this is the spectrum. We use two models. One is called reinforced frame, including slab effect. Another model is reinforced frame, excluding for the slab effect, to see what's the difference between the two frames. So initially, we applied pushover analysis. We applied one cycle, and we push it. But whatever we observed that, in case of there is a slab, we need more forces to achieve the drift ratio, or 3.5 drift ratio. So this is the beam sway mechanism for both cases, including and excluding slab. And this is beam elongation, and this is combination of sway and beam elongation. So this is for individual beam growth per story. So we found that for first floor and for the roof, the beam elongation is this. Others for the floors located at the center of the building has more beam elongations. And this is also shear, base shear. Just look to the base shear. The presence of the slab, how much is it? If you are not considered the slab, I'm just going to lose 20% of the base shear value. Okay? And it is start to decrease gradually up to the roof. You see here, I'm just listen to me, this is very important. So this video, just see this, this is the Romaco software. Just look here. So this is the first mode. So the time period is 1.72. So this is the second mode short shape, you see, the frame. This is second mode shape. This is the third mode shape. So hereafter, I'm just going to apply the seismic load. See the seismic load now, and the Cuba earthquake. So the, see the structure how it starts to shake. I showed only first, second, third. You want to see it again? No, the thing is because I already, this is not run, this is video. I can show you this. this is the all the response results. I'm just going to skip it because the student seems that they are tired. So this is very important. This is the base shear, maximum horizontal story shear under the central earthquake, North Ridge and Cooper earthquake. So see here, very important thing. Why? Because the frame was swaying under the central earthquake within the elastic limit. It's not cross the yield point. So where it is cross the yield point, it's cross the yield point in North Ridge and Cooper. Cooper earthquake was more significant and having more spectrum value. You just see the contribution of the slab was very obvious. Why? Because it's cross the yield point. So this is also the axial load fluctuation for the columns located at the exterior, at the interior. I'm just going to skip this one. This is the moment it increases due to the presence of the slab. It is observed that 5, 12, and 17% is an increase due to the central North Ridge and Cooper earthquake, respectively. Also, the energy dissipation capacity will be more in case of we are going to consider the slab effect. So this is the beam elongation historic curves versus drift ratio for all the force five-story, individual five-story for the central earthquake. This is for North Ridge earthquake. We have here more beam elongation. Why? Because it's yielded, as we said, once start to yield, start to increase more than its gain. And this is more effective and more obvious in the Cooper earthquake. So I will just going to skip these conclusions. I will come to the suggestion for the incorporation of the slab effect in building design code. So far there is no such provisions for including tension slab in Indian code, Turkish code, and European code. So we are about to write these articles and I review it and we are waiting for the final decision for the reviewers. So I will divide this one for the reason, current code provision, and study suggestion. So that the first one, slab effect has a significant contribution. It can increase significant effect on the performance of the subassembly under seismic loading. It can increase the negative flexure strength by 60 to 70%, and at the same time it can increase the column demand by 30 to 40% if not considered properly. In case of this also, the strength, the shear deformation at the panel zone is increased by 30 to 42% if we are going to consider the slab effect. So this is a few codes around the world, like America, New Zealand. They already suggested some provisions to consider tension slab, but the thing is they suggest only one value. So our suggestion is what? It depends on the design drift ratio. If I'm designing my drift ratio is 1.5, I would have small slab effect, small contribution. If I'm designing, if my drift design is 2.5%, I will start to consider more contribution for the slab. So it should be based upon the design drift ratio, and this is the formula, simple formula, which is suggested to consider the tension slab. So as you see that on the top of the beams, I'm assuming that the all bars having the same strength and start to reduce the contribution of the bars as it's increased the distance from the face of the beam, okay, to the perpendicular direction. And this formula is variable to the drift levels. So this is, thank you for this. This is some of the literatures which is published in international reference journals, three papers for this, and we are waiting for the fourth one. And this is another applications for the same award. And this is some references which is used during this experimental. Thank you for listening, and I'm sorry because I took too much time.